Thank you very much for tuning into this third video of Dr. Johnson C. Philip on Bibliology. We appreciate it very much. We keep uploading new in-depth videos regularly in English, Hindi, and Malayalam languages. Please click the thumbs up icon, the subscribe icon, and the bell icon below this video before you proceed. This will be a great encouragement to everyone who is involved in producing and distributing these videos. God bless you.
Thank you very much. It has been a privilege teaching at TERC, and it has been much more of a privilege handling a subject which is very close to my heart, and that is bibliology. What does the Bible say about itself? I am thankful to the participants. Seven of you last week sent me questions, and others who wanted to ask but did not ask, let me remind you, please send your questions to me through WhatsApp, and I will integrate those questions into my classroom teaching so that everyone is benefited. A lot of questions that came to me would be of much benefit to everyone. So in the last two classes, we looked from the Word of God. We saw that Bible is the inspired, infallible Word of God, and that the original writings, they were, even the very words in original writings were there because the Holy Spirit wanted those words there. Immediately, a question comes to mind, and that question has already come to me. And the question is, if Bible is the inspired Word of God, why are there so many translations? That is because it is the original Greek, original Hebrew and Greek manuscripts that were inspired. And now that we are translating into our languages, these have what is known as illumination. It is slightly different from inspiration. I will come to illumination later. I also wish to remind you that no two languages are equal or equivalent. In English, we often use the word sincere, and everyone understands the meaning of sincere. But in Indian languages, there is no exact equivalent for sincere. So when the originals are translated into other languages, including English, a 100% exact translation is not possible. One translator might be able to see or understand a passage clearly, whereas another translator might understand another passage clearly. That is why there are so many translations, and that is why there are some variations within translations. Some people consider variations as contradictions. That's not right, because the same idea can be expressed in a number of synonyms. So all the Bible translations express the same idea, but in different words. Then there was a question, which is the best translation? Oh, it seems that my volume is low. I apologize because today only my computer crashed, and we had to rebuild everything from scratch. I hope the volume is slightly better now, and please help me by increasing the volume, speaker volume on your devices also. Lord willing, by next week, I would optimize my computer for sound. Yeah, it's a problem, mainly because the computer crashed today. Then, related to that is the next question, which is the best translation? There is nothing like a best translation. We can ask which is the most accurate translation. There is a difference between an accurate translation and best translation, because the best depends upon that translation which helps you to understand the scripture in the best possible way. English is not my first language. For me, English was not even my second language. I had to learn it the hard way. And therefore, when I started studying the Bible using English translations, the Living Bible was my first choice because it's written in such a simple way. So at that time, when I started, that was the best translation for me. Eventually, from that, I graduated to Good News Bible. From that, I graduated to New American Standard Bible. And from that, I graduated to King James Version. So if the question is which is the best translation, my advice would be the best one is that one which you are able to read and enjoy. Which is the most accurate translation? If that's the question, then King James is reasonably accurate, but many manuscripts were discovered after King James translation was done, and therefore the New American Standard Bible is more accurate, and the Revised New American Standard Bible is perhaps the most accurate translation. Then there was a question related to that. What is wrong in reading or using New International Version? There is absolutely nothing wrong if you read New International Version with the understanding that here and there, the translation is not literal. So if you read with the understanding that it is a non-literal translation, there is absolutely nothing wrong. And here I want to take a minute to warn you against all those people who claim that this translation is by the Antichrist and that particular translation is by the Antichrist. Please remember, except for Bible translations where the meaning is deliberately twisted by cults, false cults, none of them is of the Antichrist. And I very much remember there used to be a grand old American preacher. His name was L.R. Shelton. He published a number of books saying that Revised Standard Version is an Antichrist version. No, that is not right. Revised Standard Version was translated by a group of theological radicals. Some evangelicals were also there. And because of that, they have taken some liberties. But it doesn't make a translation, Antichrist translation. On the contrary, RSV is one of the more accurate translations, except for some omissions and some deliberate translations here and there. So which is the best? The one that you enjoy most. Which is the most accurate? New American Standard and Revised New American Standard are the most accurate. King James is fairly accurate. But it is not 100% accurate because translators had their own biases and prejudices, and some of the best Bible manuscripts were not available at that time. And therefore, though it is one of the best, it cannot be labeled as the best. Which one? There is another question related to that. Somebody said, I am completely confused by all these translations. You are confused because you do not understand the reason and purpose for multiple translations. We have to understand that to convey the meaning of Hebrew or Greek into English or any other language, multiple translations are necessary, and every faithful Bible expositor should make it a point to consult the passage in multiple Bible translations. Let me show you something. I'm very seriously working on some Bible commentaries, and this is one of my most important tools. I'm not sure whether you are able to see it because a left-right inversion is involved, and I'll have to fix that as I configure my computer. this is New Testament in 26 translations. And I want to tell you, for a Bible expositor like me, this is one of the best tools that I could get, because I'm able to see exactly how the same passage has been translated by various translators and how these translations reflect all the possible meanings of the original statements of the Bible. So don't think that these translations are confusing. They are confusing because perhaps you are unable to handle multiple translations. And if you are a person at that level, stick to that translation which gives you most satisfaction. But gradually try to move on to the more literal translations, because they take you closer to the scriptures. There was another question, because the other day I said, we read from Psalm 147 saying that God has given divine revelation only to Jews. He has not given divine revelation to non-Jews, and also that non-Jews don't understand it. So I got a very, very nice question. And the question is, if God gave revelation only to Jews, then what about the book of Job? Because Job was not a Jew. He was a contemporary of Abraham. When we say that God gave revelation only through the Jews and to the Jews, our statement is about the written revelation. God directly spoke to a lot of people. God spoke to Pharaoh. God spoke to Nebuchadnezzar. We also see when the writing on the wall came at the time of Daniel, God spoke to a Gentile king. But please remember, whenever God spoke to a Gentile, or whenever God worked in the life of a Gentile, the interpretation always came through the Jew. It is through the Jew that God ultimately spoke. The story of Job, while Job was a Gentile, the story was written not by Job, it was written by, or the history of Job was written by Moses. So when the Lord says that he gave his revelation only to Jacob and not to anybody else, that means to Israel and not to anybody else, that statement is about a written revelation, not about the way God directly talked to people. When God talked directly to people, that information came to us, and we realized that it was God who spoke, only because Jews, starting from Moses up to Malachi, wrote them down and gave them to us in manuscript form. In the last few classes, I reminded you that everything there in the scripture is by God's guidance. We read 1 Peter 1:20, which says that no prophecy of scripture is of any private interpretation. That is Old English. What it wants to say is that nothing in the scripture has come out of a person's private viewpoint or private interpretation. We also saw 2 Timothy 3:16, which is a very key passage, which says that all scripture is inspired by God. We also saw Psalm 114, the last two verses, which very clearly say that God gave his written revelation or verbally inspired revelation only to the Jews. Here, the scripture makes it very clear that it is a unique book. It is a unique canon. We will discuss the word canon later, but it is a unique canon, or it is a unique codex. The scripture very clearly says that if anyone rejects the canon, he will reject the whole counsel of God. This I am sharing with you or presenting here only as a background information. I hope you remember the story of the Sadducees who came to the Lord and said, Lord, there was a man, he died without children, so through the Leverite marriage system, his brother married her, and then the next one, seven men married her, and all that story. First of all, Lord said, listen, when they are resurrected, they will be like angels, and therefore there will be no marriage there. And then the Lord says, you are confused because you do not honor the scripture. Lazarus, when he was sitting in Abraham's bosom, the rich man pleaded with Father Abraham to send Lazarus to his brothers so that Lazarus might preach the gospel and his brothers might accept Christ. Abraham said, no, son, that is not possible. And he said, Father Abraham, if one of the dead becomes alive and goes and shares the gospel, they will believe. And Abraham immediately said, they have the scriptures. If they don't believe the scriptures, then even if a person arises from dead, they are not going to believe. This I wanted to share as background information because the last 2000 years of church history have shown very clearly that anyone who has questioned the reliability, the authority, or the uniqueness of the Bible has eventually rejected the entire Bible. There are some who say New Testament is God's word, Old Testament is not divine inspiration. Anybody who speaks like that would eventually reject New Testament also. In fact, their loyalty to the New Testament, if we examine them carefully, we would understand that it is only a loyalty limited to their lips. The scripture uses a large number of words to describe it. Those who make dictionaries have found that the more you have to deal with a person, behavior, or substance, or a product in your society, the more would be the words that you would have in your language for that particular person or thing. For example, it is estimated that the Eskimos who live with snow and ice throughout the year have something like 100 to 150 words to describe snow, because it's all over and they have to describe it and they have to describe various states. So many words are there. Similarly, since the scripture plays a decisive role in the lives of believers, the scripture itself uses a number of words to describe itself. Some of them are common words that all of us commonly use, and some of them are uncommon words. Let me give you some examples. We call it the Bible. That comes from the word Biblia, which means books. And Bible in the New Testament repeatedly uses the word Biblia in Greek. So Biblia is one word used frequently in the Bible for itself, and it is from there that we derive our word Bible. Examples, I would read the Bible verses fast. You don't have to note them down. Lord willing, within a week or two, this entire outline would be made available to you in PDF form. And at that time, you can check these references. Mark's Gospel, chapter 12, verse 10, 15, 28. Luke 4, 21. Biblia is found in John's Gospel, 2, 22. Romans 4:3, Galatians 4:30, and so on. So that is one word that the scripture uses for itself. Another word which is very important and which is repeatedly used by the scripture, which has been sort of blotted out of our minds and our vocabulary, is the scripture. When evangelical preachers stand up in pulpit most of the time they have only one thing to say. Paul says this, Peter says this, Jude says this, Luke said this. Somehow or other, the scripture says, or the Holy Spirit speaks the following through. These are expressions which have been completely blotted out of our mind. As I reminded you, this brainwashing has been going on for last 300 to 350 years. And I urge every brother and sister who is listening to this class to reclaim the biblical use and not to get into a pagan expression. For a pagan, it is not Holy Spirit's word. It is not God's word. It is not scripture. For a pagan, it is Paul's word. Let us stop using that kind of expressions which were introduced into the Christian church by the theological radicals who were completely paganized. The scripture itself repeatedly uses the word the scriptures or scripture. In Greek, graphe. Graphe means the writings. And in many places, graphe, the word for holy, is added with writings. The holy writings, and often King James Bible translates that as the scriptures. So once again, before I move to the next point, brothers, sisters, this is God's word. This is not Paul's word. This is not Timothy's word. This is God's word, and therefore let us start emphasizing and start using the expression God's word says, the scripture says, the Holy Spirit speaks through the apostles and the Holy Spirit speak to us. Let that kind of expressions come. So the scripture is another name used for the word of God in the word of God itself. And we find that in Mark's Gospel, chapter 12, verse 10, Luke 15, 28. We see the same thing in Romans, Galatians, Timothy, Peter, and also the Gospels. The Gospels frequently use the word the scriptures. When Father Abraham spoke to the rich man, he said, let them read the scriptures. When Lord Jesus spoke to the Sadducees, he said, you are confused because you do not believe in the scriptures. That's a very biblical word, and that should be just as frequently as the word of God uses, we also should use it. The third name used for the Bible is the word of God. The word of God, yes, it's not invented by humans. It is an expression that we find in the scripture. And this is, again, a very important expression because this shows, by using this expression, the Bible shows us exactly the kind of attitude that we should have towards the Bible. When you just say, oh, Paul wrote this, Peter wrote this, the attitude is, Paul was a human, he could have made mistake. Peter was a human, he could have made mistake. No, we need to remember that the scripture itself has another name, and that is the word of God. What's the problem in standing in pulpit if we use the word of God says, the scripture says, Holy Spirit says. So word of God is another expression. We see that in Mark's Gospel, chapter 7, verse 13, John's Gospel 10:35, and as we proceed, we find it in Romans, we find in Corinthians, we find in Hebrews, Thessalonians, and so on. So the word of God is another name we find throughout the Bible. And then we also find the expression testaments or covenants. The old covenant, the new covenant, and the old English for covenant is testament. And that's why we have the Old Testament and the New Testament. If we use the expression the old covenant and the new covenant. There is nothing wrong with that. And people here who are from Maharashtra, let me remind you that when the new Bible was translated into Marathi, the New Testament is known as Navakarar. So modern translations have taken that into account, that the scripture talks of itself as the first part as Old Covenant and the second part as New Covenant, and the expression covenant is found throughout the word. So this way, the scripture uses several names for itself. The scripture also uses several comparisons. Comparisons are a way of expressing things figuratively, so that we are able to see it in front of our own eyes. We talk about lion-hearted men. In the same way, the scripture also uses comparisons. Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 29 compares the scripture with fire. Is not my word as a fire, says the Lord. It is not Jeremiah who says it. Let me remind. So once the scripture is compared with fire, the all-consuming fire, that image is clear to us. The scripture is all-consuming fire, and one should not be careful in handling the fire, and also one should not be careless in handling the fire, and one should not carelessly fall into fire. The fire also purifies. The fire also purges wood, hay, stubble, God's judgment. And God uses the scripture for judgment in many ways. So fire is one of the comparisons used for the scripture. Another one is hammer. We all know that a hammer can be used to break even the biggest mountain. Some years ago, there was a story of a man who wanted his village, his people in his village, to have a shortcut to the place from where they used to draw water. The villagers had to go around a mountain and walk almost something like 3 or 4 kilometers. This man single-handedly, with the help of a hammer, cut a path through that rocky mountain somewhere in Madhya Pradesh. Hammer is a small tool, seemingly small, but it is able to break a lot of things. Jeremiah 23:29 says, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces, even if the rock is a thank you, Dr. Noel. Dr. Noel is posting these references in the comment box, so you can see it from there. You can actually copy and paste if you are on a computer. That means the audience. So a hammer might be only a kilogram or 2 kilogram in weight, but it is able to break mountains which are hundreds and thousands of tons of rock. The scripture seems like just any other book bound between two, probably thick covers, but its power to break people, its power to break nations is great. The scripture is also compared to lamb. Psalm 119:105 says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. So the scripture is compared with a lamp and also light. In the New Testament, we find a special expression, and that is milk. Milk for growth. We find that reference, one of them, in 1 Peter 2:2. 1 Peter 2:2 says, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby. All these comparisons show various aspects of the Bible, and the faithful believer should consider all these aspects and should remember that since the scripture is compared with all these, in my life, the scripture plays a role that all of these things play in our day-to-day life. Ephesians 5:26 says that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water. If you read only this much, it might seem that this is talking about baptism, but no. Cleanse it with the washing of the water by the word. So the word of God is also compared with water, which cleanses. And then the most important New Testament reference. And in fact, all of us should memorize that verse. We should make our children also to memorize the word in their very childhood. And we find that verse in Hebrews 4:12. Hebrews 4:12 says, "And the word of God is alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing even to the asunder of the soul and the spirits and the joints and the marrows, and it is a critique of the thoughts and the intents of the heart." So actually, these three verses related to Bible, we all should memorize. One is Bible is the sword of the Spirit, and then all scripture is inspired by the Holy Spirit, and also that verse which says that no scripture is of anybody's private opinion or private interpretation, but rather holy men were inspired by God to write these things. These three verses, these are key verses related to the inspiration and infallibility of the Bible, and every sincere believer, every growing believer should memorize these three verses and make their children also to memorize, along with the fourth one, and that is Psalm 147, the last two verses, which make it very clear that in Old Testament times, God spoke only to the Jew and through the Jew. As far as the New Testament is concerned, the Jew-Gentile distinction is gone. We are all one, and all the New Testament books have come through church age believers. They were all actually believers from the Jewish dispensation, but on the day of Pentecost, they all transferred into the church age, and all the 27 books of the New Testament were written by church age believers and church age believers alone. I wish to emphasize that we need our children to memorize these verses, because there is a strong movement within Christendom to claim that there is revelation outside the Bible. There is a strong move among us to claim that non-Christians, if they don't have revelation, at least they copied substantial portions from the Bible, and now it is in their holy books. There is, first of all, let me tell you, there is nothing like that. No non-Christian religious book except Quran has any quotations from the Bible. And as far as Quran is concerned, as to how and why they got these quotations is known to all of us. So I will not dwell upon that. But our children who go into this world and who are surrounded by 100 devils who try to brainwash them into believing that there is Holy Spirit inspired revelation in other religious books also, they should be made resistant. A vaccination should be given. These four biblical passages are the vaccination. Please pass it on to them. Within the Bible, there is a classification. One is the Old Covenant and the other is New Covenant. And this classification is not man-made. The scripture itself uses the Old Covenant for Old Testament and New Covenant for the New Testament. And there are a number of references about Old Covenant and New Covenant. We find many of them. We find in Luke's Gospel 22:20, Hebrews 9:15-28, Hebrews 9:15-28, 1 Corinthians 11:25, and a lot of other places. So that much about the names which the scripture uses for itself. Direct names like Biblia and the scriptures, and also comparisons like water for cleansing, milk for growth, and sword which pierces. Having said so much, a question that comes to our mind is, okay, Brother Johnson, we understand that Bible is a unique book, and the Bible itself makes it clear that it is a unique book. But would you be able to throw some more light on the word inspiration? Yes, light can be thrown on that word inspiration negatively and positively. First of all, a negative thing. We all say that I am inspired. We are all people who are inspired by one or more things. Writers are inspired by certain things. Poets are inspired by other things. Collectors are inspired by other things. And a person like me, I'm inspired by books. Give me a book anytime. I would have no problem enjoying it. When we use the word inspiration for the Bible, it is not talking about that kind of an inspiration. If I'm inspired by a book, if you are inspired by a stamp collector, and if a third person is inspired by a story, these are human inspiration, a motivation, a kind of motivation which immediately uplifts our spirit to do something, to write something, to speak something. When the scripture uses the word inspiration, it means that writers of the scripture who were inspired by the Holy Spirit, they wrote everything exactly as the Holy Spirit wanted them to write. If the Holy Spirit wanted them to report about a lie that was spoken by the devil in the Garden of Eden, then the Holy Spirit inspired Moses to record it accurately, so that 3,500 years from the time of Moses, we can get that story accurately and exactly in the words in which the Holy Spirit or the Holy Scripture want us to read or hear. That's the meaning of biblical inspiration. And it means that when these 40 writers wrote, they wrote without omission. That means whatever the Holy Spirit wanted them to write, they definitely wrote it down without error. Scripture is God's word. God is not the author of confusion. God does not make mistakes. And therefore, this is the Holy Spirit inspired word of God. It is free of error. It is also free of exaggeration. You might ask, why do we speak about exaggeration? Because when we talk about the age of Old Testament saints or patriarchs or Old Testament fathers, many of them lived 600, to 900, some of them came close to 1 millennium. That is no exaggeration. That is the literal truth. That is exactly how it happened. So Holy Spirit inspired Word of God means the 40 writers who wrote the Holy Scriptures, they wrote without omission, without error, without exaggeration. The key verses, actually there are numerous verses in the Scriptures which talk about these things. Right now, these days, I'm doing a very special study of all the Bible verses that talk about the Bible and its inspiration. It's a very difficult task. So I have started with New Testament, hoping that the Lord would allow me to go through at least all the New Testament passages. But brothers and sisters, I want to remind you that throughout the Scripture, we have references about inspiration, infallibility, and inerrancy. The two key verses I have repeatedly mentioned here, one is 2 Timothy 3:16, which I have quoted many times and which I shall quote many times, not only in relation to bibliology, but whenever we open the Bible. And 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all Scripture is given by the inspiration of God, inspiration of the Spirit, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, inspiration in instruction in righteousness. 1 Peter 1:20 says that, knowing this, that no prophecy of the Scripture of any private interpretation, for they were holy men of God, spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. It was not their word, it was Holy Spirit's word. It would be useful to compare the inspiration of the Bible with the way other religions claim their scriptures came. A comparison is good because many a times when we talk with people of other religion, a background about what they have in mind is essential. Because when a Muslim says that his scripture is inspired, when a Hindu says that his scripture is inspired, he doesn't really mean exactly what you and I or the scripture means by inspiration. Muslims say that their scripture came by pure mechanical dictation, the way a stenographer, a faithful stenographer, takes dictation in shorthand and then writes down, types everything. They say that their scripture came by direct dictation from their God through the agency of an angel, perhaps the chief angel. That has no connection with biblical inspiration. The Hindus say that their saints heard a lot of things in the remote past, and after they heard, they subjected all what they heard to logic. Two words are often used in Hindi or Sanskrit, Shruti, that they heard, Yukti, logic. So what they heard, they subjected it to human logic, and what they found perfect according to human logic was written down into their scriptures. That is not the way the Bible came. So when you talk with a Hindu and he says our scriptures are inspired, you need to understand what he's saying is that they heard and they subjected it to human logic, and that is how their scriptures came. It has no connection with the Holy Spirit. It has no connection with direct divine revelation. There are some who say that Bible is inspired, but if you listen carefully, what they mean is that when you read the Bible, if you get an inspiration from it, then that inspiration is from God. They reject the idea that Bible is the Holy Spirit inspired word of God. There are others within Christendom who would say that, yes, yes, Bible does contain the word of God. But if you carefully analyze, what do you mean? What exactly do you mean by saying that Bible does contain the word of God? They will say that all the 66 books taken together contains mostly what humans wrote. Even the words of Jesus were not really spoken by Lord Jesus. They were written by humans according to their fancies and fantasies about what Lord Jesus might have said. These people claim that a few portions here and there, maybe some in Psalms, some in Sermon on the Mountain, are God's word. The rest is not God's word. That is what they mean by Bible contains the word of God. So please remember, when you talk with people, you should very carefully understand what their background is and exactly what they are trying to say when they say that Bible is the word of God. You need to listen to them carefully. The Neo-Orthodox, when he says Bible is the word of God, what he's saying is that this book is nothing. This scripture is nothing. When you read it, it speaks to you, and what it speaks to you is the scripture. It also means that if you read a passage and it speaks something to you, and it speaks exactly the opposite, diametrically opposite, ethically, theologically, logically to somebody else, that is the word of God for, inspired word of God for him. No, that is not the way the scripture talks about itself. The scripture reminds us that God's word came through the agency of the Holy Spirit when the Holy Spirit filled those men. And gave them words that they should write. Of course, there is a dual authorship. The Holy Spirit did allow those men to express their personalities also. That's the way God operates. Why did he operate like that? That's up to God exactly why he did that. As we cover this much ground, several questions which have come to me have now become relevant. One question was, man is fallible. Why did God use fallible man to get the scriptures written? My dear brothers and sisters, there are a lot of things for which the why is not answered. Why did Lord Jesus suffer for mankind? What did he see in us? Well, he loved us. Other than that, we do not know anything. But one thing is clear from the scripture. If we look at the 4,000 years of written history in the Bible, we notice one thing. The infinite God, the infallible God, has always used finite man and fallible man to attain his goal and purpose in this world. God chose Adam and Eve to be the first. Adam deliberately sinned. And then God said, the Messiah shall come as the seed of the woman, and he shall crush the head of the serpent. But to bring the Messiah into this world, God did not create a special human lineage that was uncontaminated. Men from Adam up to Mary, the human mother of Jesus, were all sinners. And the sins of some of these people are recorded in the scripture. So in other words, the scripture makes it known to us very clearly. The scripture doesn't tell us why God used fallible humans, but the scripture does make it clear that God chooses, and he chose fallible, sinful, wicked human beings to fulfill his plan in this world. We know about Jacob, who was so crooked, but he is also one of the great grandfathers of Lord Jesus. So if you ask this question, why God did not dictate everything, the biblical answer is God could have dictated, but God chose whether it is to bring Messiah to the world or to bring his word, the Bible, into this world. He chose fallible human beings as his instruments. That should fill each one of us with gratitude, because after the day of Pentecost, he has chosen you and me, the fallible human beings, full of sin, corruption, and rebellion, to execute his plan in this world. See, when we study bibliology, it is not a mere theoretical subject or theoretical understanding. It should fill us with gratitude that, Lord, you used 40 fallible men to give God's word to mankind. You used fallible men to fulfill your plan in the Old Testament and also in the New Testament. Therefore, Lord, the minimum that I understand today by studying bibliology is that I am one of those fallible creatures whom you have called to execute your plan in my life. Thank you very much for listening patiently. Thank God for making it possible. I hope that this study of bibliology would not be a mere theoretical study, that it would motivate you to be faithful in your call. God bless you.